Good evening, everyone. Thanks. What an enthusiastic crowd, and lovely to see so many women out here today. And great for the men to feel once in a while like they're in the minority. it's wonderful to be here. Love to share my story with you. I was this quiet kid growing up. You wouldn't tell it now. In fact, I've asked people to kind of cut me off if I talk too much. So at any point of time, if I'm going on and on, please put up your hand if you want to ask me a question so this doesn't just become me talking. I want you guys to be very interactive as well. So I started off not being a very sporty person. I tried a little bit of badminton. I had very bad eye-hand coordination. I tried a bit of gymnastics. I was scared to death of falling off the beam. So safe to say my parents didn't have very high aspirations in terms of sports. My dad, you know, loves Steffi Graf. He kept, you know, buying me tennis rackets, like these junior tennis rackets. I would just like sweep the floor with them or something. Wasn't very inspired. And then, so I was about 5 years old playing with some friends and got accidentally pushed into a pond, a small fish pond. And obviously, I was five, so the water was over my head. And my dad reached in and pulled me out. It was just maybe a few seconds, but a lot of panic and gulps of water, you know, disgusting pond water. And I had quite a bit of hydrophobia after that. I refused to go anywhere near a pool. And then I lived in Chennai at the time, and it was very, very hot. I'm sure all of you now, even in Bangalore, you want to just dive into the nearest pool, don't you? It's like really hot. So my dad convinced me, he said, look at this scorching heat. Let's go and, you know, enroll in some swimming classes. So I was nine. My dad took me over to the local pool. And the first day, our teacher decided that we need to be thrown into the deep end. So how many of you have learned like that? Oh, it's like everyone pretty much, yeah. So before you even learn any skills, you're chucked into the deep end. So I went down and came up, scratched at my instructor a bit, swallowed a lot of water, and came out immediately after day one and told my dad, that's it, I'm not getting in anymore. And then my dad had some very wise words. He said, I don't care. I paid 100 rupees for your classes. So you better get into that pool and finish your classes. And I guess back in the day, in the 90s, 100 rupees was a lot to a young kid. So that's what kind of got me to stick in swimming. But I didn't learn a thing by the end of the course, but maybe got over a little bit of the fear of the water. They actually had us in a pool where we could stand. And finally, it was my dad who realized, you know, he would have to step in. He's just a moderately good swimmer, never swam in the sea or anything, but he managed to teach me just the basics of swimming. And I really started enjoying the water. It became like a family affair. My sister was an asthmatic. So we just decided, let's all go together to the local pool and have fun. And maybe because he made learning so much of fun, before you knew it, I could, you know, maybe swim half a lap of the pool. And that's when I saw a team training in the lanes next door. And I went up to the coach and asked him if I could join. And he said, the day you can swim a lap of the pool with proper technique, with breathing, then you can come and join my team. So I trained like crazy for a month and went back after a month. And I was one of those annoying kids, you know, like, sir, you know, could you check me out? So finally, he gave me a chance, and like they say, the rest is history. Now, swimming is a really tough sport. So I'll just run you through an average day in my life from, say, the age of 10 all the way till I retired at the age of 24. We would get up at 4:30 in the morning by the time I'd moved to Bangalore. So you can imagine how Bangalore is at 4:30 in the morning when you know you're going to get into a non-heated pool. Very tough to get out of bed. And from a very young age, I knew my dream was to go to the Olympics. And everyone around me laughed. I was a skinny kid, pretty shy at the time. But my parents obviously had that belief. And from day one, my dad did whatever it took, my mom did whatever it took to get me to the Olympics. So the first thing he did was get me a postcard with the Olympic rings on it and stick it next to my bed. So the first thing I wake up to in the morning, you know, the sight of the Olympic rings. So that got me out of bed really quickly. And, you know, in the morning, we had just a few minutes to get to the pool. You know, they call them tiger moms, but I had a tiger dad. He actually made me jog next to the car many a morning to the pool. A bit scary on some not so well-lit Bangalore roads, but really kind of got me warmed up, ready to swim. We'd swim from 5 a.m. to about 7:30 a.m. Quick breakfast of whatever my parents could get their hands on in the car on the way to school. Then I was in Sophia's school over here, so they were nice enough to, you know, let me come in a few minutes late maybe, but I had to be present there for exams, for tests, for everything. Try to finish my homework quickly in lunch break. Then again, have a quick bite on the way to the pool in the evening. In the evening, we'd swim another 2.5 hours. So we'd swim maybe about, at the peak, I would swim about 16 kilometers a day and 6 days a week. So by the end of it, trust me, you have no energy left for anything. So, you know, I can't remember. I've never touched a cigarette when I was 13 or 14. I never went to friends' parties. I don't think I've ever slept later than maybe 9:30 in the night. But it really taught me so very much. Many, many years down the line, lots of hard training, I came up to my first big opportunity, which was to try and make the Indian Olympic team in 1996 for Atlanta. And I was only 14 at the time, but I was one of the top swimmers in the country. So swimming has a lot of events. So in a few of the freestyle events, I was the top, and we had other girls as well who were good. So all of us tried to make it to the Olympics, and all of us failed. We didn't reach the qualifying times. And unfortunately, this is India. There's a lot of politics involved. The federation can then send one person that they choose, and suddenly this Indian-American girl who'd never swum in India, who obviously maybe there's some cash went, was handed over under the table. We don't know what happened, but suddenly this girl who no one's ever met or seen compete in India went and represented India in the 96 Olympics. And when my parents went to protest and, you know, tell the federation, swimming federation, that it was very unfair, their answer was, you know, she's only 14. She's got a lot of time left. You know, she'll get her chance. And so that's when my dad really said, you know, I'm not paying anybody, paying your way to the Olympics. You better earn your way there. So I think a crucial period of my career, my swimming career, was 1996 to 2000. So we literally trained with a 4-year plan. So that's one really good thing that sports taught me. From a very young age, we're taught to have goals every single day. We have a little diary. I have my diaries over, you know, my 15-year career, where every single day we are trying to think of some timing, we're trying to think of a goal. My goal was obviously to reach 2:07, which was the Olympic qualifying. But to get to that goal, I had so many others. And I remember 4 years of planning. I managed to get a scholarship to go to Australia. I was really lucky. At the same time, it was very, very expensive. My parents actually sold their house in Chennai and moved us to Bangalore, then sent me to Australia, put all that money in, you know, something like 80, 90 lakhs over my swimming career. But that's how much they believed in my dream. My sister swam too, so it was really good. And when I got to Australia, I found that things are so very different over there. In India, from get-go, I would have only negative comments, right? My own grandmom once told me, you know, Nisha, you're a girl, and you'll get really tanned, and who will marry you? So, yeah, I mean, unfortunately, she was not alive at my wedding, but I got married to a wonderful guy, and my kids are like as white as lizards, I kid you not. In fact, in summer when I'm very tanned for my swimming and I'm walking with my kids, they keep asking, oh, you have really cute adopted children. I said, no, they're my children. Yeah, so I mean, just ridiculous stuff like that. And you know, things like my coach would tell me, you can't wear shorts at the pool. I said, I don't understand. We're in swimsuits standing next to boys in the same lane, but you're not going to let me wear shorts. And he says, no, these are the rules, you know. You like it or there's the dough. So, you know, we had to wear track pants, you know, zipped up track pants, even in summer in Bangalore. You know, so we went through a lot of this. We had some really creepy sports officials at competitions who tried to proposition us. We had coaches who tried to tell us that we should take, you know, performance-enhancing drugs. So a lot of stuff along the way, but I had a really good support staff, which was my parents, you know, our team. Swimming is an individual sport, but really you can't go anywhere without your team. And I think that's why I encourage everyone to always put their kids into sport. Even if they don't get to the Olympics, like my kids are already playing sports at the age of 4. I have beautiful twin girls. You know, one is already saying, I want to be an Olympian. And she has no clue what that means. She's seen my Olympic medallion. But the other one says, Mommy, that's too much of hard work. I'll stay at home and watch the Olympics on TV with Papa. You know, so it's good, but you know, you never know. The one who said that might be the one who actually goes and wins India a medal, right? So the idea, the reason of putting them into sport, I learned so much. You know, when I went to Australia, they have this amazing attitude, never say die attitude. And I would remember, you know, just the way our team was. We had a great team, no doubt, in Bangalore, but we're always complaining, oh, my arms hurt. Like, I've never climbed up stairs without having excruciating pain in my legs. When I would say something like, I have so much of a body ache, the Australians would just say, stop whinging. You know, it's all good. You know, you've come here, you know, get on with it. They don't want to hear, you know, how tough your life is. They're like, just get on with it. You have a lot of work to do. So I think it was a combination of having a good support team there as well. We had professionals. I had somebody telling me, you can eat that pasta with white sauce, but you can't eat it with tomato sauce. I would somebody taking your weight every day, somebody telling you to pee in a little cup for your drug tests, you know. It was a lot of hard work, but the competition before I was trying for the Olympics, so one competition before the Olympic trials, you know, I got in for a competition, stood on the blocks, just felt really good. No pressure because this wasn't the big meet coming. And my parents, my mother and my sister had flown down for that critical time to give me that support. And I remember getting into the water, and I don't know if you all feel this, but when you're working sometimes, or some of you are athletes before, you get into something called the zone, where everything just starts falling into place, where you're hyper-focused, you feel incredible, you drown out all the distractions. And I really felt like I was in that zone, and swam a great race, and I touched the wall second in my heat. And this was the Australian Junior Nationals. And, you know, looked up and saw that 207 was a qualifying, and I just gone a 206, you know. My mom was almost falling off the stands with excitement. And, you know, the best part of, you know, I think my career or till date was, you know, calling my dad and telling him the good news. So 2000 was a phenomenal year for me. I got to meet the President of India because I got conferred with the Arjuna Award. And, you know, it's so amazing to be in Rashtrapati Bhavan. And they put a little square carpet. Thank you. Yeah, so I heard that at the nomination ceremony, I mean, at the nomination meeting, the jury meeting for the awards, that people said, why are we giving an award to an 18-year-old? And one of somebody I looked up to, which is P.T. Usha, happened to be on that committee, and she said, this is the age that we need to encourage, you know, sports people and sportswomen, so why aren't we giving it to her? So thanks to her, I actually got the award. So when, you know, fast forward, thanks. You know, they put a little square carpet in Rashtrapati Bhavan, at maybe 50 meters from the President of India, and you have this long briefing ceremony about how you have to look down at the floor, no smiling, no moving from the space, no trying to reach across because there's obviously security, you know, and everybody else would just stand and look down while their name was read and their achievements were read. But then I was 18, right, so I thought, let's have some fun. So I kept looking up and, like, waving at the President, you know. And, you know, he was so amazing that he waved back. And, you know, such an amazing moment when they were taking us all for a little walk around the room at the end. I, you know, broke out of the line and introduced him to my parents who are, you know, like, in shock. And the security guards are waiting to pounce on them. But, yeah, really great year. So I can still remember the great memories of meeting some of my big heroes like Leander Paes, seeing, you know, the best in the world, Muhammad Ali, who came into the dining room, you know, all of us trying to go near him. So, you know, it's like you guys are talking about diversity and inclusion. Nothing better that symbolizes really diversity and inclusion than the Olympics. You have people from all over the world. You have para-athletes. You have people from various fields. But when you're at the Olympics, you're all Olympian. You're treated alike. You know, we could go anywhere in Australia with a little badge and people would look up to you with such pride. So I remember not a dry eye in the house when the Olympic flame was being lit. You know, so I really went from the peak, I would say, of my sporting career. I was really pumped up. Like, I'm going to win a medal for India in the next Olympics. I'm going to train for these next 4 years. And then, bang, I was hit with my first big setback, I would say, in my career. I started having very bad back pain while I was in Australia, before I even came back home. And as an athlete, we're taught to enjoy pain. You know, we're a little sadistic. They say, pain is good, you know, first time you're young. I still tell my four-year-old daughters, they come back from gymnastics class, like, we held the, you know, the rings for a very long time and my hands are hurting. I said, good, pain is good. They're like, okay. So if you tell people pain is good from a young age, they believe it. So this is all good pain to make you get stronger. But suddenly I was getting really bad back pain, so much so I couldn't sit. At that point, I was in Mount Carmel College. Any Mount Carmelites here? Ooh, okay, good. Yeah, proud Mount Carmelites, yeah. So I got permission from my lecturers to actually, thank you. I got permission from my lecturers to actually stand at the back of the classroom because even sitting down was hurting me. I had really bad pain running down my leg. So it took a very frustrating 2 years where I think I went through every single emotion. I mean, sports does teach you to, you know, learn from your failures, you know, all that, never give up. But those 2 years were just, you know, torture for me in terms of, you know, physically being in pain. Mentally, like, you know, people saying you can't get back, she's done, you know, one Olympics and she's retired. People questioning. I had one doctor who told me to my parents, he pulled my parents aside and said, I think she's imagining it, you know. That was the most annoying thing for me, you know, as an athlete. You know, we do something called lactic acid tests where we swim 5 times 100 meters, and after every 100, they prick your fingers and really press your fingers and get your blood, so they test you, and they do it many, many times. You know, so we're used to pain on a regular basis, and here was this doctor saying that I'm imagining it. So very tough time, and 2 years later, 2 years of lost, swimming that I could have been trying for the next Olympics, and finally it was diagnosed as a benign tumor on my backbone. So obviously everyone thought, I mean, they said tumor in the backbone, that's it. So my parents were freaking out, thinking it could be cancer. I was freaking out, thinking, you know, I can't swim anymore. And finally I had surgery with this amazing doctor in Coimbatore, and he said, be prepared to not see a swimming pool again, because we might have to put a steel plate in your back with screws and the works, because we don't know if it's affected your back. But I had a great team of surgeons. They made sure they removed the tumor. They checked that it was not cancerous. The biopsies came back negative. And about 10 days later, I was in the pool. It was a very long, hard road. And of course, this is not a fairy tale ending. I trained really well for the next 2 years. That's 2003 and 2004. But narrowly missed that next Olympics, which was 2004. I missed by about 0.30 of a second. So that's 30 milliseconds. Yeah, so that's sports. We live for this few tenths of a second. And that's when I decided, you know, my parents were really struggling financially. And then I said, it's time for me to call it quits. But I really love the sport of swimming, and it's given me so much. So I said, I need to get back in there. So I started teaching, and that was back in 2005. And now we have a really great team of coaches. We train in many centers in Bangalore. We have our own Olympic 50-meter pool. And this summer alone, I think we'll have about 5,500 people coming through all our different centers, you know. So it's great to be back in the sport. Thanks. Yeah, it's great to be back, and you know, just some of my learnings from swimming. But before that, if any of you have any questions, like I said, I can go on talking. Maybe it's something to do with swimmers just swimming many hours, staring at a black line, and being in the water, you cut off all your senses. So when we come out, we are really noisy. Very talkative, right? So you guys have to stop me. So any questions or anything you'd like to know about my swimming career, or yeah, there you go.